We move on to the last keynote of the day. And Rob Holst. Rob is the Program Manager Data Stewardship at the Dutch Tech Center for Life Sciences, DTL. And he's also Technical Coordinator for the Dutch Elixir node. He's been collecting information on good practice for data stewardship since already 2012 and is applying the FAIR principles to these since their inception. So please, Rob.
Yeah, no, thank you for inviting me. This is, of course, a challenge now to be the last speaker, the final keynote, because I will have to reflect, of course, on everything that I heard in the previous talks, both Eric as the first keynote and the individual talks. So Eric showed how the FAIR principles came to be and how they facilitate the transition to a world in which all the data works together to solve big societal problems. So he showed mostly facilitating what sometimes is called data science. And of course, a lot of what we are doing becomes more and more data science. I would like to present how actually applying the FAIR principles can not only help the world, but also the individual research projects. So FAIR is mentioned often as something that we have to do. We must do FAIR. And we see in practice that it's very hard to get started. I want to give a few hints on how to get started. So we all know that data in practice often is not reusable. And some of that is caused by data not being properly documented, some of it by data that's not really standardized. Some data could be not reusable because it cannot be found or there is no good way to request access to the data. What I would like to show first, actually, in my talk is that FAIR assignment is not only something that we need to do, but it actually can help your own research. So Nicholas asked Georgios already about how much it costs. I hope to show that it's an investment that pays back strongly. It's not only a cost position. And then this is not only for the data that you collect yourself. We are all reusing data that is already there, and not all of that may be as FAIR as you need it. So also for data that you're reusing, it's good to think about FAIR. I will make sure to show some steps that everybody can make on a journey towards FAIR, even if we have heard many of the difficulties that people encounter earlier. And I'll finish by pointing you to two tools that you can help you to identify additional things that you can do after the initial steps. So we've seen the FAIR guiding principles, and I refer to it as a FAIR journey. That has a reason. So some people say, I'm trying to make my data FAIR, or the data is FAIR, but their data is not either FAIR or unfair. I argue, actually, that no data will ever be completely FAIR. And one way of looking at this journey is as a ladder of the four letters. You make the first data findable, then accessible and interoperable and reusable. The idea is that if you want to make the data interoperable, but you forget to make them findable, then if they're not findable in the first place, you cannot interoperate on them anyway. But it is more fine-grained than that. The 15 FAIR guiding principles can each be approached independently. For each, you can say, what am I currently doing here? What could I change to make things a little bit better? And not only to make the data FAIR for other human beings, but also for computers, with great benefits when things need to be automated. For instance, in the COVID-19 statistics for 180 countries in the world, it's nice if everybody uses the same definitions. So Eric, of course, went through the principles, and after his talk, Nicholas asked how to measure the fairness, and the FAIR data maturity model was mentioned. So the Research Data Alliance built this FAIR data maturity model, which is a series of yes/no checks that you can do on existing data, and some tools have been made afterwards to do this automatically, and really checking the details of the different aspects of what the FAIR principles are saying and how you are doing that. And of course, the tools exist to do this automatically. And it's very tempting to just say, okay, I'm apparently 65% compliant. But I don't think that's the way you should use this. You shouldn't use the numbers that are coming out of these tools. You should use these kind of analysis and the details of the analysis to identify how you can actually improve, how you become more fair in the future. So to make my point about FAIR not being only good for science as a whole, but also for individual research projects, I'd like to first zoom in on the last letter, the R, for reusability. And here I also use two colors for reusability. We want to make the data reusable, and in first instance, that sounds like an action we do for others, the reusers of the data. However, I draw the word in two colors because making the data reusable early enough in your project actually makes it usable in your project. You can also formulate that differently. As a researcher, you are actually the first reuser of your own data. Three times. First, tomorrow, when you want to continue your research, and you need to reproduce and know exactly what you did today, tomorrow, to go on with the work. So you're the first reuser of your data tomorrow. In 3 months, you're again a reuser of your own data, because a reviewer of your paper will ask you to make a small change, to try a small change. And you need to know exactly what you did to be able to do that. And in 2 years, when the postdoc leaves the lab and a new one needs to pick up the work, you're again a reuser of your own data. And it's very good to have all the metadata, the descriptions of the data that make it possible to start up the use. Well-described reusable data saves the day in each of these three cases. And if you see FAIR as a four-step ladder, of course, each of the steps, findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable, serves yourself as well as the others. Now I'd like to zoom in to the four letters and see, explore some first steps that we can take in every research project for each one. So for findability, again, we've had already a little discussion about a repository. So we have to choose a repository. I would actually say the best way to look at it from the first step is, where would you look for this data yourself if you wondered whether someone else would have already collected it? So there are different repositories. We've already had the discussion as well about domain-specific, maybe institutional repositories. There are national repositories, and there are also repositories that are made especially for a certain research project, a website where only that data is. And we heard, luckily, that domain-specific repositories are very advisable. And I think we can explain that by the fact that a domain-specific repository actually has the features that a researcher who wants to use that data is going to be needing to actually find what he needs. So, for instance, if you would be a language researcher and you would deposit some interviews in that specific language or all about that specific language in a generic repository, then that generic repository, of course, can only offer download because it doesn't know what to do with an audio file. But if you have an audio file or a language specific repository, then you can first listen to some samples before downloading it. And the same is true, of course, for any other kind of data. Genomics data is the same. You want to be able to browse a little bit and select the data that you actually need to download before you actually download it. You could use different repositories for different data if you have one project, and then we've heard several examples of that as well. The budget, of course, also affects where you're going to put it. I definitely say if you want to do it again well in a project, then go early in the project, talk to repositories, and ask them what they need, or maybe they have that on their website. They require a certain format of the data, certain metadata, and they can help you to make it easier to actually deposit the data. Then, of course, and we've talked about that a lot, and Eric has mentioned the importance, get a persistent identifier. So persistent identifier, like a DOI for a data set. What I see often is people say the data can be found using the DOI, and what they mean is that the paper gets a DOI and the data is associated with the paper. It's dumped with the journal. That's, of course, not the way we mean it here. The data set itself should actually get a DOI, or probably more than one, because of the metadata and the data both requiring to be found. And another thing that you can do to make your data findable is to describe what it is and not how you collected it. I've had a beautiful example from someone who said, if you have X-ray of the torso and you use them to look at the spine, because you're a bone researcher and you're looking at the spine, then often what will happen is that this data set will be deposited as a data set of X-rays of the spine, but it's not what they are. They are actually torso X-rays, and somebody who is doing studies of blood vessels can see the aorta on the same X-ray, and that way these images can be used in a completely different way. That is a very important step. So describe what the data is, an X-ray of the torso, and not how you used it or why you collected it to study the spine. And if you want to describe data with the kind of keywords, then librarians actually can help. Librarians and archivists have training to actually identify what things are. So Google, go look for your librarian and let them help you to tag the word. And then the last thing is, if you have chosen a repository or maybe even more repositories for your data, then often there are catalogs that bring things together. If I would be a researcher, I would not be looking in an institutional repository for the data. So it's good that even if your data is deposited in the institutional repository, because that's where you are obliged to put it, you can still register the data in a catalog where others will be searching for it. That's important. So that's findable. Let's now go to accessible. So one thing that people really don't want to hear with accessible is that you have to make sure that the data is actually still there when people want to access it. So you have to make sure that it's still alive. If you use a your own website, we know that 20% of websites decay per year for some kind. So use a certified repository and make sure that they transfer the data to another repository if they decide to go to stop their activities. And actually, certified repositories are certified. And this is one of the things that they are certified for, that they have ways of recovering the data if they actually stop their activity. Software longevity is another issue, and we've heard several of the talks talk about how to make sure that the software still will be available. So legal conditions are very important. We've heard also about privacy. So there are legal conditions applied, and you have to sometimes ask for data to be able to get access. But getting that access should not be coupled to a person like the PI. So data available on request is not really good. I would say, and that's often what I tell people when I see a data management plan, define clear rules that are needed to get the data. What are the rules under which you will get access, and then have an objective data access committee judge those rules and the compliance with those rules to get the access, not just data available on request whenever the PI feels like sharing it with you. And legal conditions are important, but there are also non-legal conditions, and I don't like those. So if there are no other reasons, then you should actually limit the embargo that you have and not have arbitrary restrictions on the data. Really helps for others to reuse it. This is, of course, for others, not much for yourself. the ICT procedures, being able to make backups during your project is also a part of assuring the longevity of the data. Let professionals take care of it. It is really a job. So that's what I want to say about accessible. Then interoperable. And for interoperable, there are three things that I would like to separate out. The format of the data should be something that other people are also using. If you're describing variants of genomes, then use, for instance, the variant format, the VCF format for that, because others are using it well, and that makes things interoperable. Terminology is another important thing. So we want to have terminology standardized. And obviously, if we're doing health research, it is we will use encodings for diseases so that somebody who is describing something like a cancer knows that somebody else who is describing a malignant neoplasm is actually using the same, describing the same thing. So if we're using an encoding for this, then that is clear. What is much less obvious is if we want to make our data interoperable, we need to do that for every field. So also, for instance, for geocoding, we want to have the locations like Brussels also located and done in the same way as geographers would do that, in order for our data to be able to link to geography data. So in 1854, this was done by hand by John Snow, making a map of water pumps in London to identify the source of a cholera outbreak. But we want to be able to facilitate this automatically. And I've heard a nice story as well about somebody studying Arabidopsis genomes, where they suddenly thought, hey, can we find out whether some genomic variants were more likely to occur if the plant was growing at high altitude? And because the geocoding was standardized, they could actually go to a Google Maps API to find out how high it was growing. So very important for interoperability is that you need sufficient metadata to interpret the data unambiguously. And this is something that was mentioned very many times in the meeting. It must be, and that's the way I have expressed it, it must be impossible to misunderstand for someone else, even if he's trying. And that's actually a nice exercise that you could do if you want to see whether your data is annotated, whether it's well documented, is go and sit with a group of people and try to make a joke about how to misunderstand the data. So this is an example of interoperability. So these are two patients, both visiting a doctor. And they're coming from two different data sets. And we can read this as human beings, but computers cannot understand this data. If you imagine that you would would have this for more than two sources, more than two columns, for instance, five sources and 100 columns of data, you can see that interpreting this kind of different formats of dates, different descriptions of a sex, it's going to take a lot of time. Eric showed 79% of the time is in this kind of manipulation of the data. So you really want to have standards for that. And actually, for many of these things, standards exist. So for dates, we have ISO 8601. For sex, we have ISO 52818. ISO 52818 may be too easy for, too simple for medical research, just having 0 or 1 for a man or a woman. But if you need something more complicated, it also exists. Go and look in fairsharing.org. You will find these kind of standards, as well as standards for encodings, formats, and everything else. So that rounds up the I, and then we have only the R left. Reusability talks a lot about metadata. So that's the technical term for describing what your data is. There are different forms. Different forms of metadata exist. So I've heard people say, well, yeah, I have metadata. I have Dublin Core metadata. But that's one kind of metadata. But there are many kinds of metadata that you actually need to to annotate the data to help this clarification, to help avoid clarification requests from others that are reusing your data, and to help yourself to actually know what you actually did. You need to describe how your data was obtained, the provenance, instrument settings, and the that kind of metadata can actually be automated. So if your workflow actually has that possibility, collect that metadata automatically as soon as possible. That really helps yourself as well. There are minimal metadata standards. There's minimal metadata standards actually are quite extensive. You would need to a lot of things, even though it sounds minimal. And I actually would suggest that you volunteer to do the optional data too. So there are universal ones like Dublin Core, but Eric also mentioned them. The domain specific metadata is very important. The license, are you obliging people to cite? Are you forbidding commercial use? Such clauses may sound easy, but they really have consequences. If you do that, you are limiting the data. It is very difficult to combine data with different license options. And I often say, okay, let's imagine that Gauss, when he published the normal distribution, would have said, you need to cite me or to be able to use it. Or actually, he could have said it cannot be used in a commercial setting. Imagine what we would have right now. So you and Bernie had a good insight and published it once. He said other scientists will cite you anyway. They will need to prove that they got the data from a reliable source. So they will cite you. Don't worry. You don't have to oblige them. And that's actually the way we're doing it for papers as well. And the last item here is you really need to make sure that you are not encoding your results in narrative and then people need to text mine it out again. Please help to make text mining obsolete. So data stewardship comes to all of these things. It is, and a lot of the projects that we're doing are dependent on digital data. FAIR is relevant for every researcher. Every researcher needs knowledge to deal with data, but a lot of the data actual work is a specialism. It's a range of specialisms in itself. And it really becomes useful to have this work and leave it to an expert. And these experts can be part of the research team. They can be part of a supporting organization internationally in Elixir. A lot of work is being done to define what we are expecting from such experts, setting up skill profiles, working on education and recognition for this work. So, from my arguments before that any researcher is the first reuser of his own data, you can see that aiming for FAIR is a very good guideline for making your day-to-day decisions about data management. Actually, every time you have a data choice, you can ask yourself what the influence of that choice is on the fairness of the data. And in many cases, it really helps to make the decisions actually early as part of the planning process. If you collect the metadata early, it really helps you. If you make the data interoperable early, it really helps you yourself as well. We are ensuring that the project benefits and FAIR is not done as a time-consuming afterthought that's only good for others. Of course, there's much more you can do than the four simple slides that I showed now for each of one letters. I hardly touched on machine actionability yet. And that's why for more than the first steps, I'd like to introduce you to two new tools, a tool for data management planning and a reference manual for data stewardship. So in Elixir, I work together with Elixir Czech Republic on a tool that can guide researchers to good data management. It's called the Data Stewardship Wizard. And the Data Stewardship Wizard is built to ask the first few questions about data management that an expert would ask if you would address yourself. If you as a project owner with an ID for a project would go to a data management expert, they would ask you some questions, and the idea of the Data Stewardship Wizard is that it asks you such questions. It has many questions, but they're structured, simple questions. There are no open text boxes, and it only opens relevant questions, and it allows you to collaborate on the data management planning. So the goal of the data management wizard is the actual planning, not the plan. This is different from other tools that are aimed primarily at making the data management plan. The actual plan is useless in my opinion, but the process of planning is very important. And this process is supported by the wizard, which functions as this expert system with many IDs and optimal things encoded in the questionnaire. Rather than having to choose techniques that you already know, the wizard can help you to find ways to do things more efficiently, and it can also prevent you from running into unexpected difficulties. It helps you to make the choice and to find the expertise needed to implement it. And in the end, if the funder requires it, it also writes the data management plan if that's necessary. So I'd like to take a minute to describe three situations that can call for external expertise and that that really show you what the value of such an expert system is. So many universities and institutes have lists of services that help you to do data management. But I doubt that these are useful. If we look at what the external expertise, when you're calling for external expertise, then there are irritant problems that you say, I know that there is a service for this, but where do I find this expertise actually? This irritant problem is something that you can solve using a list of services. And if you can't want to find it back, then you can use a list. What you cannot use a list for is the painful problem of, hey, I now realize, or I've been told that my problem is actually equivalent to something that other people have. I didn't know that I don't need to make my own backups, that there is a service for it. That really would save time, but you wouldn't look, if you don't know that the service exists, you wouldn't look there. And the data stewardship wizard is meant to help you there. And it also helps you for the it tries to help you in the dangerous situation where you say, okay, I'm going into a project, but you don't actually realize that you will go and encounter a certain problem. And that's really a dangerous where also your budget and your result are in danger. The data stewardship wizard, as well as data experts, of course, that it's trying to supplant, is a good way to help there. And a case in point as well is, how do you get apps on your phone? Many of the apps on my phone, I got referred by a friend, an expert, from using that tool, not by using lists of apps and searching through them. So the data stewardship wizard also actually creates the measures of how fair your data will become. So this will even give you a fair metric before the data exists, in contrast to the fair maturity model, which only works on data that already is there. So this again is something that you can do prospectively. And this is not done as an exam. So it doesn't in the end give you a note for fairness. Actually, every question will tell you, if you choose this option, your data will become more fair. So that's the first tool. The second tool that you could refer to is a general Elixir tool currently being worked on in Elixir Converge, a big project. And it's called RDM Kit. And this is really a system that helps to document all the options that you have for data management and the best practices. So it pulls the expertise and writes that up in a set of documents. For search situations where you need to look up how to do things, where you can lose a list, Elixir is working on this toolkit. So there are different entry points in RDM Kit to look for information based, for instance, on where you are in the data lifecycle, the type of task you're performing, or which research subdomain you're in, and all the information there is cross-linked. RDM Kit links out to many resources containing more information, including the test training database of Elixir and bio.tools for tools. And there are links to and from the data stewardship wizard as well, so that anyone browsing RDM Kit can make use of the decision trees in the wizard, and the users of the wizard can benefit from the overview and context given in RDM Kit. Behind the system, there's a whole set of experts who have in workshops, as well as individually, contributed to the material. And it also includes a complete description of how you can make your own contributions. Here I want to close it off. I've shown that, I hope, that investing in fair data benefits not only others, but also your own research. Nevertheless, I only often get the question, how do I pay for this? And as an answer, I compare data stewardship with laboratory safety. If you imagine a laboratory safety officer telling you that he has no time and funding for doing safety planning because he's too busy putting out fires and providing first aid to people with glass cuts. Unfortunately, many of us have gotten used to data fires and other data mishaps, and we are like that safety officer. We need to recognize that proper data hygiene can actually prevent these problems and make our data intensive research more effective. And if we can reduce that 80% to 40%, instead of 20%, we can use 60% of our time doing actual research, tripling the efficiency, not by reducing data management to letting the data management reduce the overhead to zero, not only halving it, triples the amount of time that we have left over to do science. It's not needed that you struggle to reproduce your own results on two successive days. It's not needed that you fight to find your data back that you worked with last week. Proper data management based on the FAIR principles is a valuable investment with a huge payback. I call upon everyone to start preventing data fires as from today, instead of extinguishing them.
Thank you, Rob. Do we have questions? Volmar, please.
So maybe more of a reflection than a question. So you mentioned that the DMP itself might not be the most useful artifact, but in fact, the journey of coming up with the content of that plan is the key takeaway, so to speak. So investing in good practices or going through this journey once will put you in a better position for your future projects. And investing in doing it properly, like documenting why you chose to do FAIR in a specific way and manage your data in a specific way, is something you probably can reuse in your upcoming future projects. So I just wanted to add that, and I hope you agree, or if you want to reflect on that, please do, Rob.
Yeah, so very much agree, Walmart. There's one thing that I would add, and that is that the data stewardship wizard actually is not meant to do this process only once. So you can actually update the data management planning in the future. Because, strategists in war have said, no plan actually survives contact with the enemy. And that's why you need to update your plan continuously. During your project, you will find out that you need to change things, and it's better to document it, to make the choice consciously, document the choice, and then at the end, the data management plan is a document that describes how you actually did things instead of some dream that was there before the project started.
Great. I saw Paulette raise a hand, but maybe you've gotten your answer.
Yes, indeed. Thanks, Bob. Just that was along these lines, elaborating on the planning. But Volmar and yourself just clarified this very perfectly. Thanks.
Thank you.